So I'm an Apache committer, but I want to tell I'm technical. And I position myself as an architect and a technology evangelist. And I drive a Mazda. I love Mazda. I play basketball, so I like Kobe. You might not like Kobe. I live in San Jose, next to the Santa Clara Levi Stadium. So I like Colin Kaepernick. Cap is the best quarterback, I think. I listen to Linkin Park. And these are the two kids that I have. If you see two mice running during the afternoon party, probably these two might be. Okay, so this is a strategy tag. Actually, we planned this thing to give you a complete insight on how you build a platform and then what are the necessary stuff that you required on building this platform. So that's where we line up this thing. So we have one customer talk. Unfortunately, the last talk, Andrew, he couldn't make it. So Jonathan Marsh, our VP of strategy. So he's replacing Andrew and then giving a talk on the open source value proposition. So that's the track. So basically, I thought of start with the evolution of the programming languages. I think you might have started your career in different levels. So I started at C level, but did some assembler programming as well, and then corrupted my hard disk, because in assembler you had to tell where you are putting the input. So I put 00 and thought of sending it to the CRT, but unfortunately it went to the hard disk, so 00 basically the boot sector, and then it got corrupted. So this is the evolution of the programming languages. So parallel to that, we identified what's the evolution of the platform. So this is what we identified. So the first thing called the platform 1.0, that's where the mainframe and before, that we call the centralized computing. Then after that, most interesting part came, that is about messaging, SOA, EDA, those type of stuff. As well as with that era, the internet came into the picture as well. So it powered all the distributed computing with internet. Then today we identified that's not enough. So SOA can do certain stuff, EDA can do certain stuff, but then again, it's not enough. That's where we identify the platform 3.0. Basically, it's platform 2.0 and the next generation middleware that we call as the cloud. So the cloud is more kind of a marketing term, but that's not what we are referring here. I will go in detail during my talk. So if we look at platform 3.0, what required in platform 3.0, we identify a bunch of features that should contain in the platform 3.0. First thing, we identify it as cloud native, that you should be able to deploy it in a virtualized environment, infrastructure as a service, or like the new technologies like container as a service, and then it has to be multi-tenanted, and then it has to be dynamically scalable, then you should be a tracker, monitor everything, as well as you should be able to do billing and metering, so and so forth. So the platform 3.0, by nature, it should have the cloud native features. The second thing is about open source. So the open source, I think Sanjeeva explained this as well. So a lot of people think it's about the cost, but it's not the cost. The main advantage of open source is the freedom that we get, as well as the collaborative, and then sharing the ideas, work as a team. And the other advantage that you are getting, you can extend the default behavior of the software, because it's really hard to find a product that will cover all the requirements that you are looking at. So the, with open source nature, you can extend the functionality and then get exactly what you are looking from a platform. That's the next thing. So if you are interested about the open source advantage, the Simon, who's from Wipro, did a really good keynote during our last conference in London. So the video is available. That's a very interesting talk, why you should use open source and the advantages of that. Then the third feature of the platform 3.0 is API driven. Everything is API driven. That's how you integrate internally as well as externally, and standardize your integration. So that API driven nature is there. We call it as API everywhere. Then the next feature is polyglot programming, because it's really hard for you to tell a programmer to develop application using a certain language. We have to give them the freedom to pick the language, like it can be Java, .NET, JavaScript, or any other language that they like to do the programming and develop the application. So the API-driven nature enables this, because any language can call HTTP, and any language can process JSON. So whenever you have a standardized API, then you can give the freedom for the application developers to develop the application using any language. Then the next thing is quality of services, because we used to build applications and then embedded quality of services inside our code. That's what we did some time back. But today it has changed, that the middleware provide all the quality of services that you required, like security, throttling, caching, different type of quality of services, including some system level stuff as well. So middleware should provide it, that you will engage and disengage it based on your need and based on your different type of application. So that's another feature of this. Then the mobile, social, store, those type of things I don't need to highlight, because without mobile social features, it's really hard to market your applications. And then the store provide a lot of advantages for us, because it will create a marketplace for us to advertise the cool stuff that we are doing in the backend. So that's where the store come into the picture. Then the event-driven, some thing that I really like as a pattern, publish and subscribe. So event-driven is a core functionality, and then with that you can plug new architecture patterns like Internet of Things, and then handle different type of messaging flows. Then the big data analytics, I think again I don't need to highlight, you heard about it during the morning sessions, why we need it, as well as it's kind of a core part of the platform. Then the DevOps, actually DevOps was not a friend when, if you look at it, 5-6 years back, we developed the stuff, and then when we try to go and deploy it, then only we hear, you can't deploy this thing, it should have these type of standards, or it has to comply with some other things in the environment. But today it has changed. DevOps is part of our product teams, and then they are working from the day one, helping with the architecture, as well as make sure these things will come in a stable, and then meet your performance, so and so forth. So DevOps is part of the this process as well. So that contains things like continuous integration, continuous testing, those type of things that help us to release the product on time with quality. Then the last thing is called the iterative nature. So iterative implementation and iterative architecture, because you have to build the stuff in an iterative manner and then meet your milestones, rather than you have a kind of a complex architecture and then try to do certain stuff within a certain time period, like because we used to have like 1 year, 2 year project plans, but it has changed today. It's probably a month or 2 month type of iterative plans that we have. So those are the key features that we have identified on Platform 3.0 that will help you to build different type of solutions. So this is compliant with this new concept called microservices architecture. So I call it as kind of a pragmatic microservices architecture, because even Sanjeev mentioned this thing that we can't take everything from that architecture pattern. There are certain good things. So I'm not going in detail about this today. So tomorrow we have the architecture pattern track, and then I'm doing a talk on pattern-driven enterprise architecture. So we will go in detail during that session. It will be at 9 a.m. tomorrow morning, I think, the same room. So with this, we identified this concept called modern applications are system of systems. How it derived, like system of system is basically you have small components, reusable components, collect, connect, and then build a larger system. That's the whole concept of system of systems. So Gartner identified this thing some time back with three-layered architecture called a system of record, system of differentiation, system of innovation. And then this is little bit too high level and little bit visionary for an architect to build an application. So it didn't properly work with this this architecture diagram. But recently, Forrester came up with this better way of positioning this system of record, system of engagement, and system of automation. So basically, system of record is data and then data-related stuff, how we access, and then the processes relevant for that. And then system of engagement is the engagement channels, that how we build applications like web apps, mobile apps, so on and so forth, and then provide the access for the consumers. System of automation connect everything and then make the processes more productive as well as stable. So that's where it comes. So we took the first idea and the second idea, as well as a couple of our customers were building enterprise architecture based on this concept. So Paul Fremantle, our CTO, me and Paul, we worked together and then came up with another view of this thing. It's a two-dimensional view. So this is the first version of this diagram. We are still working on and improving this thing. So why this is two-dimensional? If you look at from this layer, you will find different type of architecture layers. So at the bottom, you see all the source system of record, that where the data will physically get stored. And top of that, you have the system of record, how you access the data. Then you need some kind of data virtualization, because most of the data models that we have in our system of record layer is not compliant with what we required from the services or API layer. So we need some kind of data virtualization. Then top of that, we get all the traditional service-oriented architectures related things like the ESB, orchestration engines, message brokers, service registries, so on and so forth. Then our definition of a service is the implementation, but service is not consumable. The consumable unit of the service is the API, that you expose the services as API and provided access to your consumers. That's where the API layer come on top of the SOA layer. Then you get all the delivery channels, the applications that you build, and then where you market the applications. Those things will come on top of the API layer. And you can see the system of automation is going through all the architecture layers, because it helps to plug these things using infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and application lifecycle management. So next version of this diagram, I need to add the container as a service as well. So all these things supports that. So that is one dimension of this view. And then you can see the other dimension. Basically, you develop the stuff, you publish the stuff, and then you need runtimes to run this stuff. And then the quality of services will come after that, the security, governance, monitoring, like that. So if you look at the enterprise architecture, I think most of the things that you required will cover here. But that doesn't mean you need everything. So you can pick the, you can prioritize the stuff and then pick what required, as well as you can see what exists in your data centers or your enterprise architecture, and then try to reuse them as well. So we built this diagram as a kind of a reference architecture, and then we did the product mapping of how and where these things will fit. So the new products are not mapped here, like the microservices server and then the gateway, but all the existing products are mapped, and then you can see we cover most of the stuff that you can find. Some of the products actually represent two different places. I didn't put them, I didn't duplicate it, because then the diagram will get complicated. Then to simplify that view, we created another diagram, like having a limited number of layers, and then categorize this stuff as well, because the previous diagram is better for an audience like you who can understand, but sometimes we need to simplify it, so we came up with this simple view as well. Then the next thing is about platform. So this is a definition given by Dave Gray. So he wrote a book called The Connected Company. Actually, if you have not read it, it's a really nice book, how you can build a connected company. So he defined the platform, because it's kind of a must to build a connected company. So this is his definition. I'm not going to read it. So based on that, actually, we identify this platform nature. So what we did, identify different type of platforms that will be in this the bigger enterprise architecture. So things like integration platforms, mobile, API management, app development, security, IoT, so and so forth. So different type of sub-platforms that we call it as platform of platforms that will connect and then create the bigger picture. So why we need a platform? So the first thing is demand coming from the business stakeholders. We don't know what type of business requirements are coming. So when we have a platform, technically we can extend the current business functionality and provide what they require. So quickly we can release the features that they are looking at. So that's the first reason, because the demand is really high from those guys. And then the second thing is rapidly changing business requirements, because those things are not certain that those things are rapidly changing. So we have to change the technical side as well as release the products based on that. Then because of those two, the quick release cycles come into the picture. With that, you have the continuous integration and continuous testing. Then the not only business requirements, the technology is changing as well. Like we talk about JMS, AMQP for a while. Now we are talking about MQTT type of messaging. So the technology is changing. So having a platform that supports these type of new technologies will help as well. Then the last thing is providing middleware as a service, that you provide the integration platform for your developers, you provide the application development platform for your developers, as well as you provide the API management platform. So this concept of providing middleware as a service, again, a necessity for especially for enterprise architect groups. So that's another reason why you need to build a platform. So the first, then you might think, do I need the entire platform? Answer is no, because it's based on the iterative architecture and iterative implementation. Since you have the iterative architecture and iterative implementation practices, then you don't need everything at once. You can keep on add stuff based on your different iterations that you identify. But you have to be a little careful here, because you can divide into iterations, but you have to make sure each iteration will achieve some kind of business goals, and then it provides some kind of business functionalities for the business users. Otherwise, it doesn't work. So you have to be a little careful, and then carefully identify what are your iterations and what type of value that you are providing for your business stakeholders. Then the this is one another thing that we learn from the customers who build the platforms. Don't call it as a ESP platform, or don't call it as WSO2 platform. Give a code name, because the people who is using the platform should not worry about the technology or the vendor or what type of product using. As an example, digital platform, this is what Fidelity is using. And then you will hear about the Nexen platform built by BNY Mellon. So like that, have a proper kind of a cool name for the platform that will help you to market your platform and for your users. And then you should introduce an onboarding program, because you have a platform, but if you don't have a proper onboarding program, then you can't bring users to the platform. If there are no users, then no point of having a platform as well. So the onboarding program should have like samples, documentation, and describe the patterns, and including some training as well. Then you have to evangelize the platform, because otherwise people will not know. So you have to identify different type of channels, different type of venues, and then evangelize your platform as well. Then next thing is build foundation services that the applications developers can use, because then it will make them productivity, and then you can reuse a lot of functionalities and expose them as APIs. So that's the next level of your platform. So it will make the people productive, as well as it will help to release the stuff quickly. Then it has to integrate it, because now you bring the integration platform first, and then when you are bringing the analytics or security platforms, those things should glue together and then work properly. So the integration is a key. That's one area that you need to pay attention. Then you have to have a common enterprise architecture across different business units. As well as to do that, you have to bring different architects from different groups as well. So I call this thing as architecture review boards, that you should have a proper architecture review board with different architects, and then put all the enterprise architecture principles, so that help you to make the platform stable as well as address different type of problems different business units are having. So this is about the concepts, and then tomorrow we have kind of the next level stuff, that how you implement this. So this architecture pattern track, and then I'm going to talk about the different architecture patterns, as well as I repeatedly talk about the iterative architecture. So Chintana is going to do a talk on the iterative architecture with some examples that we have implemented with our customers. So as the last slide, now I explain, like, we have a lot of products, different type of middleware functionalities. So this is one comment came from Jin, who's the VP of Architect at Fidelity. So when we present the platform, he said it was like Christmas, because he got enough functionality and then enough capabilities from the platform that he can utilize and build a integration platform initially. And then they are planning to move for rest of the stuff like application development platforms. So the as an enterprise architect, he got a lot of functionalities available from the middleware platform to build application platforms, integration platforms for his customers or his users. So that's the advantage that you are getting from a complete middleware platform that we position as from data to screen. So that's it.